So guys, I'm a gamer.
So if you're like me, you've been eagerly awaiting any news on a new DLC character for Smash. But with the most recent DLC coming out a month ago with no new character announcement in sight, and with the Smash Bros. Team having to work from home, it seems like hype is at an all-time low. However, as you've already been informed, this is the Shaggy Rogers-esque face of one determined gamer. A gamer who, for some inexplicable reason, has become about 20% more spiritual over the course of these past few months.
That ain't zen.
So with headband on head, stubble on chin, and peace, love, and rock and roll in heart, I decided to take matters into my own hands and use what some would call bizarre, bordering on desperate methods for determining who will be the next fighters announced for Super Smash Bros. Ultimate. My first stop in this mystical journey brought me to one of the more commonly known divination methods, tarot reading.
As you can see, tarot decks have like 72 cards in them, and I only know the ones from Jojo.
It's actually 78 cards, not 72. But I guess that just solidifies the point that when it comes to the transcendental, my brain is at best being operated by a lobotomized monkey mindlessly bashing two rocks together. So for those who also have no clue how tarot cards work, here's the lowdown. All of these cards have different meanings associated with them that are meant to be interpreted to provide somebody with spiritual guidance. These decks consist of two sections with 22 major arcana, or greater secrets, and 56 minor arcana, or lesser secrets. In order to properly perform a reading, there are different ways the cards can be laid out on the table which result in different evaluations of their relevance in the subject's life. These are called spreads. What I'll be doing today is using these cards in an attempt to read Sakurai so that hopefully the fates reveal something discernible on Ultimate's highly anticipated DLC characters. But once again the issue arises, I'm a goddamn ignoramus who has no clue what's going on.
So as much as I would love to just sit here and just silently read through a pamphlet, I think what I'm gonna do is just set these puppies up, just put them in the Celtic cross, because I know that that's apparently something that is common in tarot card reading, and then future me will figure it out.
And so I did exactly that. Now, a second ago I mentioned the Celtic cross, which is one of the most common spreads in tarot readings. It involves you placing down 10 cards in the shape of a cross, all indicating different important aspects of the subject's life. I'll do my best to explain these as I go along, but before I could begin, I had to select one base card that's used as the starting point for this ritual.
There's a significator, which is supposed to represent the person that we're reading, which I guess would be Sakurai.
There's a whole process for selecting the significator, but to make a long story short, I chose the King of Cups to represent Sakurai. Anyway, after figuring out the significator, I was finally able to start placing cards down and getting some info on my first candidate for the next DLC.
The world, hey, that's his stand.
The first card represents what's happening to the subject in the present. Now, the world is not only an interesting pick just because I'm an unabashed Naruto running body pillow snuggling lowlife, but also because the world symbolizes completion, enlightenment, and a deep connection to life, which is a pretty baller opener. Whoever this character is has a deep understanding of life and how they would like to traverse it. The second card signifies the challenge, obstacle, or epiphany the subject is facing.
We got reverse King of Wands.
See, here's another fun thing about tarot cards. The meaning of the card you pull actually changes based on which way it's facing when you pull it from the deck. So in this instance, I pulled a reversed King of Wands, meaning this character is facing a leadership position they're not yet ready to fill, and maybe setting up unrealistic expectations for themselves. The third card represents what the subject is working towards and aiming to achieve.
Reverse Queen of Wands? Maybe that's interesting.
Coincidentally, I pulled the reversed Queen of Wands. This indicates a strong sense of self-respect and deep understanding of one's inner self. And considering this is what the subject is looking to gain, that means whoever this is trying to get a better grasp on who they are. The fourth card is meant to show underlying subconscious traits that the subject possesses that will guide them through their journey. For this one, I pulled the Page of, once again, Wands, which either means I didn't shuffle enough, or this character is in the midst of a sudden spark of creative freedom and restlessness, indicating the start of a new life journey. So we're just gonna go with that second one.
The Hermit. That was my father's radio name when he was a DJ in college.
The fifth card represents the subject's past and what has led up to this situation. And the Hermit represents a journey of quiet and solitude involving the abandonment of the material world, usually with the ultimate goal of reaching inner peace. So whoever this character is has probably been dealing with this introspective pilgrimage on their own for a while. The next card, the sixth card, represents the future and what's to come in the subject's life during this challenge. I pulled a reversed Fool for this one, which suggests that this journey is something they feel unprepared to undertake and that the subject holds a genuine fear of the unknown. And then at this point, I just decided for whatever reason that I was gonna rapid fire the last four cards like a rootin' tootin' cowboy. So I guess for the sake of brevity, I'll just quickly go through the rest of this reading. So cards 7 through 10 indicated somebody who is lamenting over their past during their journey, possesses an inner turmoil and anxiety that has taken control of their life, has faced past difficulties or falling outs that have left them feeling defeated and isolated, and is facing a very real possibility of giving up, leading to the mental health of the subject suffering a detrimental loss. So tying all this together, the idea is that I should have enough to pin down who the fates have decided Smash's next fighter is gonna be. And I'm gonna be honest here. As I was going through the footage and deciphering the meaning behind these cards, I was pogged out my goddamn mind, because normally in these instances, I would try to list off a few possible suspects to give a good range of answers, but this reading was just so specific that immediately I knew that there was only one character who could possibly fit this description. So, with a weird metaphysical pride in what I had just accomplished, I conclusively deducted my official prediction for the next Smash Bros. DLC character, Madeline from Celeste. Now, I know this one might be kind of a curveball, but if you've ever played Celeste, you know why this is an absolutely perfect fit. So, okay, let me go off real quick. Celeste is a highly revered platformer that explores Madeline's struggles with depression and anxiety and how she overcomes her figurative and literal personal demons by deciding to drop everything and venture out on a personal journey far from society in an abandoned city, climbing a mountain in order to prove that she should be confident in who she is and learn to take control and finally assume leadership of herself, something she never thought to be possible before this. She struggles through a few years of feeling like her mental afflictions have completely defeated her, is constantly being told to turn back, and even deals with multiple very intense but completely reasonable panic attacks throughout her journey, but inevitably is able to stay strong and never give up, and it's through this inner strength that she's able to reach fulfillment and self-actualization. And if that isn't exactly the person that I just read off of those cards, then I will literally buy every single person who watches this video the next DLC fighter personally. No, I won't. That's a verbal contract I'm not willing nor capable of committing to. So anyway, that's my first prediction for who's gonna make it into the Smash Bros. Roster, but this is just the beginning. So I'll see you guys next time when I use the ancient art of palm reading to delve into Sakurai's inner self and determine who else we'll be seeing in Fighter Pass number 2. So until then, stay groovy, folks.